All right. Now, welcome to the Odyssey Church. And if you're a first-time guest, you're going to find that we're very educational around here. For example, you may not know this, but today is a great national holiday, one that I have already participated with and one that I hope you have already participated with. Right? You may not know that, but today is National Sticky Bun Day. Okay? So in an effort to keep you on top of all the important holidays, here at the Odyssey Church, we just want to keep you informed about those kinds. So National Sticky Bun Day, originally known as Schnecken, it's believed that the sticky bun came into the United States beginning in the early 18th century as German settlers brought their baking traditions with them, and they began settling in Pennsylvania. So aren't you glad you came to the Odyssey Church today? If you don't get anything else out of the message, you will know when you leave here that February 21st every year is National Sticky Bun Day.
Thanks to Pastor Rob's sweet tooth.
Yeah, you should have known it had something to do with food, right? But there's something else you might not know this morning either. And if you're here and you call yourself a Christian, you may not know this, but most Americans probably don't like you. In fact, they say they don't even trust you, which is really sort of weird since most Americans say that they're Christian, right? But most of you know what a poll is, particularly in a political year, what poll or polling is. A poll is where you take a group of select people or a group of random people and you get their opinions in order to form some kind of analysis. I'm not sure if any of you are familiar with a group called the Barna Group. The Barna Group does a lot of things, but one of the things they do is put out a lot of research on Christianity. Do a lot of Christian research and a lot of Christian polling. And in a recent polling, here's what they found out about the average American and what they believe about the average Christian in America. Okay? And first of all, they found out that 1 in 4, that's about 24%, 25% of all Americans, couldn't even think of one single positive contribution Christianity has made in the world in the last couple of years. Not one. 20% of Americans, when they were asked what kind of negative contribution has Christianity made in the world in the last couple of years, the number one answer they gave, the number one was, violence or hatred incited in the name of Jesus Christ. Violence and hatred in the name of Jesus Christ. Now that is a terrible view that most Christians in the United States have of most American Christians, isn't it?
Yes.
To encourage violence and hatred in the name of Jesus Christ that we are supposed to love and be loving towards others because of? But that was the number one response. Number two response, 13% of Americans see Christians as homophobic. They're afraid of gays and lesbians. 12% said the church is too involved in politics. The same amount of people, 12%, cited the sexual abuse that we see on the news so often, particularly in the Roman Catholic Church. There's another company called Lifeway Research. And Lifeway Research found out that 72% of people believe Christians are hypocrites. And the only thing that surprised me about that is I really thought it would be higher than that. They surveyed people who hadn't been in church in 6 months or more, and they called those people unchurched people, and they found that 44% of them said Christians get on their nerves. Now imagine that. So when they served these people that they called unchurched, which were people that hadn't been in church in 6 months or more, they also found out that they believe in God or a higher supreme being, that it really exists, but only 48% of them, less than half, agree that there is only one God as described in the Bible, and 61%, that's over half, believe the God of the Bible is no different from the gods of the other religions or other spiritual beings that are being depicted. Now keep in mind, this is the unchurched, but by their definition of unchurched as a person who hasn't been to church in 6 months or more, that's almost everybody living in the United States, at least 75%. So the majority of unchurched Americans, 79%, think Christianity is more about organized religion than it is about loving God and loving others. Lifeway researcher, associate director Steve McConnell says the outsiders are making a very clear statement that churches aren't getting through on the two greatest commands, to love God and to love one another.
Amen.
What a contrast from the first century church. I mean, the first century church faced opposition, but they faced opposition not because people believed they were hypocrites. They faced opposition because people believed that they were not hypocrites. Completely flipped. See, the Jews almost hated the Christians because they believed Jesus Christ was the long-awaited Messiah. And they didn't believe that. But these first century Christians were so convinced that Jesus Christ was who he said he was, they were willing to be imprisoned, they were willing to be tortured, they were willing to be executed as necessary, rather than deny their belief in who Jesus Christ was and do the things that he told them to do.
It is so.
The Romans didn't like the Jews either, but for a very different reason. I mean, the reason they didn't like them wasn't because they were hypocrites. They didn't like them because they weren't hypocrites, but they didn't like them for a different reason. They felt that they were a detriment to their society. They felt that they were going to take over their society and make it something that it different was. There was no hypocrisy in their belief. And even though these early Christians, they'd taken these Jesus teachings into the pagan world, into these places that had never been before, particularly into Rome and Corinth and Ephesus and all these other places, there was no hypocrisy in what they were doing. But these concepts of loving God and loving others, they were taken with them, and the Romans felt that this was a threat to their way of life. There was a historian by the name of Tertullian from early 200 AD, and this is a report he gave about Christians. He says, Christians have a common fund into which Christians monthly deposited what they could. Now, what he went on to say was, you know, they're not just giving to this fund, but they're sacrificially giving into this fund. They're selling their property. They're giving everything they have. They're giving their food into this fund so that they do without so others can have. And this common fund was used to support widows, the disabled, orphans, the sick, the elderly, shipwrecked sailors, prisoners, teachers, burials for the poor, and even for the release of slaves. And these early Christians were threatening the Roman Empire and the Roman way of life. The Roman philosopher Plotinus tells us this: you do a beggar a bad service by giving him food and drink, because you lose what you give and you prolong his life of misery. That was their belief. You ought not give anybody anything. The classical philosophers of the time regarded mercy and pity as defects of personal character. They were to be avoided by all rational men and women, since mercy involved providing unearned help or unearned relief. It's just contrary to justice. Julian the Apostate was the last pagan emperor of Rome. And he wrote these words about the early Christians. He called them Galileans. These impious Galileans. Now, impious means lack of reverence towards God. And Galileans, as I said, is what we now know as Christians. So basically what he said, these ungodly, these irreverent Christians, not only feed their own, but they feed ours as well. And they welcome them with this agape. And for those of you that don't know what agape is unconditional love. Doesn't matter what you've done to me. It doesn't matter what you said about me. It doesn't matter what you've done to my family. I love you anyway. These ungodly Christians who have no regard for God whatever, not only feed their own, but feed ours too, and welcome them with this unconditional love. And because of that, they attract them as children are attracted with cakes. While the pagan priests neglect the poor, the hatred Galileans, the hatred Christians, devote themselves to work of charity and love by a display of false compassion. He didn't even think this was real. He thought they were just trying to topple the empire. Such practice is common, and it causes contempt for our gods. See, these Christians were so loving, and yet the Jewish priests and the pagan priests were so unloving. The Christians were causing a problem in their society. They were offering the things people needed most. They were offering them unconditional love. They were offering them sacrificial giving. They were offering them eternal hope. These first and second century Christians were willing to be imprisoned, to be tortured, to be persecuted, to do whatever was necessary, even die, rather than deny Jesus Christ and do the things he commanded them to do. And I ask you, you know, can that be said of the 21st century church? And I would have to tell you, I don't think so. Because statistically, at least here in the United States, people see Christians as hypocrites, hating gays and lesbians, homophobic, inciting hatred in the name of Jesus. And what's happened to Christianity over the last 2,000 years? Now, I'm talking about the church with the big C. I'm not talking about any particular church, and I'm certainly not talking about the Odyssey church, but I made a beat. But before we get into this morning's message, I sort of want to give you about a 3-minute review of what we've been talking about in this series we've been calling 8 Days and Alive Again. And the reason I want to do that, it sort of leads into what we're going to talk about today. Now, we've been in this series. We're calling it 8 Days and Alive Again because we're taking the very last week of Jesus' life and we're going day by day up until Easter when he was resurrected again, when he was alive again. Now, we're going to go over some of the details and events that happen each day of the week. And last week, this is the last week of his life here on earth as the incarnate God, and that simply means God in a body. God came to church in the form of man. And on the first week of this series, we looked at what the church calls the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. Hundreds of thousands of people, maybe as many as 3 million people, depending on the record that you read, were in Jerusalem last Sunday for what's known as the Passover feast. Now, the reason they were in Jerusalem was every good Jew, every religious Jew, every Jew who was truly practiced were required to go to their hometown to celebrate Passover. So they're celebrating the what we call the Exodus. We're celebrating when God delivered them from the captivity of slavery in Egypt. And maybe if you weren't here last week, you still know what the story is. You know, there's this large crowd in front of Jerusalem as Jesus enters in. They're all waving palm branches, which is where we get the name Palm Sunday. And they're all laying their coats down in front of them. Sort of like what we do on the red carpet when people that we think are coming into town in victory do. They're doing all this as Jesus rides in on a donkey. And it's a symbol that Jesus is entering into town as a victorious king. And here's the question we gave for us to think about. Are you a fan or a follower of Jesus? Because on that day, there were thousands, hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of fans out. They're all waving Jesus on. We have victory, we have victory. But when Jesus didn't do what they thought he should do, when Jesus didn't say the things that he thought that he should say, they stopped being fans. They just simply either quit doing anything or they switch teams. You know, they're like when our favorite football team wins, you know, when they won the Super Bowl. Those that were the fans were waving them on, we won. But really, did you win or did they win? You know, it's your team, but were you on the field getting dirty and doing all the hard work, or were you just sort of in the fan waving the players on?
Amen.
You know, this political year, when you're favorite candidate wins, you go, hey, we won. But were you out there doing the hard work? See, when the winds changed, the fans left. When Jesus didn't get the victory he desired or that they desired, they just sat back and did nothing. Or they switched teams. They weren't going to get dirty. They weren't going to get on the field. So are you a fan sitting in a pew waving others on that are doing the hard work, or sitting in a chair waving those on that are getting dirty on the field, leading people into the love of Christ in their families, in their community, in the world? So Jesus has this great big triumphal entry, and then he walks into the temple, and he sort of looks around, and then he leaves, and he goes back to a nearby town called Bethany to get some rest. And that was the end of the last Sunday as a human being here on earth. Now, on Monday morning, he wakes up and he gathers his disciples and they start walking back to Jerusalem. On the day before, as he was walking to Jerusalem, he had gone to a fig tree and looking for fruit. It had leaves. It looked like it should have fruit. It didn't have fruit. Jesus cursed the fig tree. And if you haven't read that story, it's a great story. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 11, and just read about it. But the next day, they're walking back, and Peter and the disciples, it says the disciples all noticed that the tree was dead, but Peter is you know, Peter's Peter. And if you know anything about Peter, he just spoke what everybody else was thinking out loud. He just said, hey, Jesus, that tree you cursed is dead. And probably the other ones are looking, I can't believe Peter said that. He did it again. But here's what I believe. I think Peter had been walking with Jesus Christ long enough to know that Jesus never did anything without it being a lesson. He wanted to know what Jesus was trying to tell him. And Jesus gives this wonderful, as they're walking back to Jerusalem, Jesus just gives this wonderful message on prayer and not doubting God and your faith being unwavering. But as he walks into town, here's the question that we ask ourselves. And we see this historical account in chapter 12, a side of Jesus that we don't see very often. He goes right back to the temple the next day where he was at the night before, and whatever he saw that night, he must have really bothered him. Because he walks right back to the temple that day, and the first thing he does is he starts turning over tables, he starts kicking over chairs. One account in the Gospel of Matthew says he even made a cord of three whips, and he's got his whip out, and he's kicking everybody out of the temple. He says, you have turned my Father's house of prayer into a den of thieves. He said, are you religious and lost? Because the people that Jesus was kicking out, they were in the inner court. What that meant is they were the religious of the religious. They were in the inner court. They weren't in the outer court where the Gentile and the women had to stay. They were inside the church building. They were the religious people. Great picture. I think it's a great picture of how we can be very, very religious and still lost. We can be very, very religious and be so close to the kingdom of God and yet not be able to enter it. Being religious and not saved from the fires of hell and the wrath of God. You know, we're doing it, but we're doing it all wrong. And I'm just going to challenge you, if you missed that message, or even if you watched it, it's up on our YouTube channel now, I think. If not, it'll be up by Monday. Watch it for the first time or watch it again, not because of how eloquently it was spoken, but it's such an important message for people who call themselves Christians, for people who call themselves religious. So at the end of Monday, Jesus and his disciples leave Jerusalem once again, and they go back to Bethany. And the very, very religious people, or so they thought, the high priest and the scribes, who were the teachers of law, they're all gathered together. And they're all having a private conversation. And they're in this secret meeting. And here's what they're doing. They're planning how to kill Jesus. Religious people planning murder. Now, I don't think you have to be plotting murder to be religious and lost. I mean, these were religious people. But as we'll see this morning, they were such sticklers for the law, they forgot the meaning of the law. Jesus even told him, he put it this way, he said, you guys are hypocrites. You honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. Your worship is a farce. You teach all these man-made ideas as if they were commands from God. You ignore God's law and substitute your own tradition. And then he said, and you got to listen to this, he said, you skillfully sidestep God's law. And don't you know religious people that do that all the time? See, Jesus, in the scriptures, never calls us to be religious, does he? What he calls us to be is disciples. And we're to be disciples that go out and make other disciples. Disciples that make disciples and keep on making disciples. And if the first century church didn't do that and believe that, Christianity would have died with Jesus on the cross. And we get so hung up on our rules that we forget to love like Jesus loves us. And we can be religious and lost. And that is a very, very dangerous place to be. So now this brings us to the Tuesday of what the church calendar calls Holy Week, the last week of Jesus' life as a man on earth. This will also, on Tuesday, be the last day of his public ministry. After today, he's going to turn inward to his disciples, and his teachings will become private. He teaches only to his closest friends, the inner 12, on these final messages of how to live this Christian life. But by the next morning, the religious leaders have come up with a great plan, or so they think. They've come up with a plan they think that's going to get rid of Jesus Christ once and for all, because they're going to trick him with his own words, And they're going to trick him into becoming blasphemous, which is going against God, and they're going to use that against him. They're going to label him as blasphemous, speaking evil against God, not realizing that they were in the very presence of God. That they were going to try to trick God with God's only word. I mean, if you think about it, this is not a really well thought out plan, is it? So the next morning, Jesus' disciples, they head back to Jerusalem. Now, and again, I'm speaking as a fool. As they're headed back, you know, the last place I would go is to the temple that I just kicked everybody out of in a pretty violent way. But that's exactly what they did. They headed right back to the temple where he's thrown all the religious people out of the day before. And of course, what this had done is really made it more popular with the common folk. I mean, the common person was starting to gather around Jesus more and more, but the leading priests, the teachers of the law, which were known as the scribes, and even the elders of the church, they're ready for him as he walks in. Jesus walks into the temple, and these religious leaders, they're trying to trick Jesus by questioning his authority. Jesus, is your authority from man? Is your authority from yourself? Is it self-appointed? Or Jesus, is it from God himself? Now they know no matter which way he answers, he's in trouble. The crowds will turn against him. Because if he says that it's from man or it was self-appointed, then he can't be God as he claimed to be. And if he says it's from God, then he's blasphemous and the crowds will turn against him. So either way, Jesus loses. But Jesus, being Jesus, turns the tables. He asks them a question. And the question he asks, they know they can't answer. Because either way they answer, the crowds are going to turn against them. So Jesus says, you ain't going to tell me? I'm not going to tell you. Nanny, nanny, boo, boo. That was Janet's part, by the way. And then Jesus begins to tell this parable. Parable's a made-up story. There's this parable about a guy who owned a vineyard, and it was time to reap the benefits of his workers. So he sent different of his managers to go and get from the farmers of the field the grape at harvest time. But every time they went there, they killed him. They killed the people that he sent. So finally, he says to himself, surely they won't kill my own son. And he sent his son, and they killed his son as well. Jesus says, finally, after this, the farmer had enough. He goes in, and he kills all the farmers that are there on the field, and he gives the grape vineyard to somebody else. And now, these Pharisees, these Sadducees, these scribes, these religious people, they want to arrest Jesus right then and there because they know this story is about them. And Jesus ends up saying, the stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. And it's wonderful to see. See, they knew the story was about them. They were the wicked farmers, and Jesus is the cornerstone. They're afraid. The crowds are too big, and Jesus is too popular. Don't think these guys came with just one question. They got plants all over this crowd. They had other religious people in the crowd with even more questions, and the questions got harder each time. But question after question, Jesus answers them all, and the answer's been all the way. They can't argue with the results. They can't dispute his answers. But they have one more question that's left up their sleeves, and this is a biggie. It's found in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12. If you have your Bibles, you can turn them now to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 12. And always, if you don't have a Bible, there's plenty of them over here by the door. Please take one. They're free. They're our gift to you. The section of Scripture, again, that we're looking at this morning is in the middle of the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 12. It's verses 28 through 34. The word's going to be up here on the screen so we can all look at the same translation at the same time. But I'm going to encourage you to get a Bible and take notes and underline in it, write it. It personalizes the message. I mean, only God gives you His Word for a reason. He don't want you to know about Him. He wants you to know Him personally. He desires to have this personal relationship with you. And I hope if you don't get anything else out of this morning's message, that you get that it is not only Sticky Bun Sunday, but it is also this loving God who desires to have a relationship with you. This account, this historical event, this conversation between Jesus and this scribe, this teacher of the law, is also recorded in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 22. And Matthew gives us a few more details that Mark sort of leaves out. For example, Matthew tells us that this scribe is actually a plant. He's there with a question to trick Jesus. But something must have happened as Jesus gave his answer, or as Jesus had been at these other questions. His views about Jesus and who he was and what he did was starting to change. But this question, it still burned in his heart. He still wanted to know the answer. Even though he no longer planned to trick Jesus with the question, he still wanted to know the answer to it. The trick question has now become a legitimate question. Mark starts out in verse 28 by saying, one of the teachers of the religious law was standing there to debate. He realized that Jesus had answered well, so he asked of all the commandments, which is the most important? Now that's a great question. And maybe no one in the crowd had ever thought to ask that question before, but once they heard it, they wanted to know the answer. See, the religious system of the day had taken these 10 commandments, and they turned them into 613 separate laws. They took 10 commandments and turned them into 613. And then they had subcategories for each commandment. Some of them were ridiculous. For example, there was no work on Sunday. God says, keep my Sabbath holy. But there was one rule said you couldn't walk without sandals and drag your toe because that was considered making a row for planting. That's silly stuff. And these people are thinking to themselves, you know, there is no way we can keep these 613 rules that we have, plus all the sub-rules that they have. So just let us know, what is the most important? We can't follow them. We're tired of being beat up for following them. Everybody in that crowd that day, even the religious people, knew they couldn't follow all the rules, but the religious people had the rules, and they put themselves above everybody else because they kept most of the rules. Now, Jesus even told them one time, you religious rulers, you tie these heavy burdens, meaning the rules, you tie these heavy rules, and you lay them on men's shoulders, but you're unwilling to even move one finger to help them out. See, here's the problem with religion. Sometimes religion becomes about rules. And religion becomes about the rules. Mercy always suffers. When religion becomes about the rules, not only does mercy suffer, but the leaders become self-righteous, don't they? And the followers become hypocrites. Keep this in mind, though. The leader in the church is not always the pastor. See, I've been in some churches, I've actually served in a church where the pastor had no authority at all. He couldn't make a single decision without the board saying it was okay. The board ran the church, and the board made sure everybody in the church, including the pastor, know that they had the power. And they became very legalistic. They became very self-righteous rule followers. But Jesus didn't die for rule followers, did he? He died for rule breakers. And when the rule breakers came in, they were so legalistic that mercy suffered. They were so self-righteous that things didn't go their way, or you didn't act the way they thought you should. You suffered, or you left, or they just simply got rid of you. And those who followed the rules became hypocrites because they thought they were following the rules when nobody else would. They're trying to get others to follow rules that they couldn't even follow. And maybe you've seen this. Sometimes the ruling person in the church, the leader in the church, is the family who's been there the longest. You know, this is our church. Our father started. We've been here all our lives. And this is the way we've always done it. And if you don't do it the way we're going to do it, then you have to leave because this is the way it's always been and this is the way it's always going. You know, some churches it's the person with the most money. You do what I say, or I stop giving my money. I'm going to hold it over your head. Maybe some of you have experienced that. That's why you haven't been to church in a while. Maybe you're just coming back now because you know that there's this God who loves you so much, but you're tired of the hypocrisy in the church. You're tired of having to follow legalistic rules. That's why we started the Odyssey Church. But if we're not careful, the natural gravitation is always towards rules, because we know how to keep rules. So we have to be very intentional. We have to be very purposeful about making this a place so loving that people come. Now, don't get me wrong. Don't misinterpret what I'm saying. there's a place for religion. I'm not saying that at all. But the gravitational pull is always to the rules instead of mercy. And if we're not intentional about it, we'll become religious and we'll lose our effectiveness in helping others. But fortunately, as we're going to see in a few minutes, Jesus tells us how we can tell whether we're religious or what we're doing what he says. You know, these 613 rules based on 10 commandments and sub-rules to the 600, everybody in the crowd saying, hey, what is this greatest rule? What is the greatest commandment? What is this one rule that we can keep the most? Which one is the most important? And Jesus, he is the master teacher. So what he goes in and he digs down into something that every single Jewish person would know. Every single religious, good Jew would know this. He says, the most important commandment is this. Listen, don't be so close to the kingdom of God and miss it. Make today the day of your salvation. God, who is the source of love, sent his Son into this world to communicate and to demonstrate his love to people everywhere. God literally became one of us. The Word became flesh and dwelt among his people to show them how to love as he loved. How to love God, how to love those around you, and how to love even those who have hurt you. Had his arms outstretched on a cross, nailed to it, beaten beyond recognition, bleeding and dying. And yet he looks down at the crowd and says, Father, please forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. Could we do that? We get upset if somebody cuts us off in traffic. The Apostle John, who was one of the three men in that inner circle of Jesus, he writes in his first epistle, or his first letter, he writes, God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. He said, I'm going to explain. I'm going to break it down to you. I'm connecting the old to the new. This is real love. Not that we have loved God, but that he has loved us. And he has sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. And dear friends, since God has loved us that much, we should surely love each other. No one has ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us, and his love is brought to a full expression in us. All we have to do is love others, and God's love is brought to a full expression. When we love God and we love others, when we do, God lives in us and his love is shown to the entire world. If you can't get excited about that, I don't know what to tell you you can get excited about. Amen. And then there was Peter, one of Jesus' closest friends. Again, one of the inner 12 as he walked the earth as a man and a member of this inner circle. He writes this letter in the first epistle, or the first letter he writes, chapter 3. You must worship Jesus Christ as the Lord over your life. Don't worship him as your Savior. Worship him as your Lord. If someone asks about your hope as a believer, always be ready to explain it, but do it in a gentle and respectful way. In other words, don't beat them over the head with the Bible and tell them all the rules. Tell them about my love. Be respectful and gentle. Keep your conscience clear and live in such a way that if people speak against you, they will be ashamed when they see what a good life you live. Because you belong to Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Amen. Somebody looked at your life. They see a life of loving God and loving others. And if they spoke against you, would they be ashamed because you lived such a good life? Because you belong to Jesus Christ? Or would they see what the world sees in Christians? Would they see a hypocrite, a homophobe, somebody who got on their nerves, someone who incited hatred in the name of Jesus? See, Jesus closes this entire section with a compliment and with a challenge. And I'm going to try to do the same thing. See, this is what I believe. And we've been open just a little over a year, and I've been in a lot of churches. And I don't say this lightly. I want you to know I truly mean every word about it. I thought about it. The Odyssey Church is one of the most loving churches I've ever been involved in. We have about 80% of our people, maybe even higher, that volunteer on a regular basis. We have people who go out into the neighborhood. We have people that come in here and help me. We have 7 or 8 people coming in here on Wednesday to start getting the church ready for Easter. This is one of the most loving churches I've ever been in. But I also know it's not a thing that I've done. See, I can be the most loving person I can be in my human experience. I can be very loving and the church still not be loving. It's the people who come here week after week and on a regular basis who make this church what it is. Loving God and loving others. And for that, as your pastor, I just want to thank you. I appreciate you so much. I know I don't tell you nearly enough. But I want us to be reminded to love God and love others to such an extent that we really do make a difference in our families, in our relationships, in our schools, in our workplaces, in our community. In order to do this, we got to be reminded of this, and we got to remind ourselves often to love God and love others who are made in the image of God. So I'm going to ask you to stand with me, and we're going to repeat the most important commandment together. Now, as you're standing and getting ready to do this, I want to give you this challenge. In your bulletins today, if you didn't get one, I can make them up before I leave today. In your bulletin today, it's just a little business-type card thing, and it has the same words that are up here on it. And I'm going to ask you to lay it beside your bed. And when you lie down at night, just pray this simple prayer. And when you get up in the morning, just pray this simple prayer. Just do it between now and Easter, okay? Do this so you remember to love God with all your heart and with all your soul and all your mind and all your strength, and to love your neighbor, who like you is made in the image of God. So will you repeat this prayer with me? The Lord our God is the one and only Lord. I must love the Lord with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and all my strength. And I must love my neighbor as myself. No other commandment is greater than these. When in doubt, let love win out. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for those that came today to hear your word. And Father, we just ask that you have opened their spiritual eyes, that you have opened their spiritual ears, and that you have opened their mind and their heart. That, Lord, as we leave here, that we'll remember to love you and love others to such an extent that people can see the way we live. That if they were ever to say a false word about us, that they would be ashamed because they know we belong to Jesus Christ. Father, we ask that you put the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, that you be among us and within us wherever we find ourselves this week. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you for coming.